Now let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America. We begin with former U.S. President and Republican presidential candidate Donald Trump touting the largest deportation of migrants in American history at a rally in Green Bay, Wisconsin recently.
They're sending prisoners, murderers, drug dealers, mental patients, terrorists. The worst of every country is coming into our country now.
Trump says with the people's vote, he will seal the border and stop the so-called invasion of migrants.
If your constitutional rights have been violated, we will defend you. If you have illegal aliens invading your home, we will deport you. We will not allow your homes to be taken from you in any way, shape, or form. We will stop the plunder, rape, slaughter, and destruction of our American suburbs, cities, and towns. And we will end deadly sanctuary cities. We're going to end them.
Still on immigration, people continued to attempt to cross the U.S.-Mexico border, but were stopped and sent back to a dry riverbed where migrants gathered around the fires by the National Guard. This as the Texas state attorneys confronted Biden administration lawyers in a federal appeals court over Senate Bill 4 recently. The controversial Republican-backed law would let state authorities arrest and prosecute people suspected of illegally crossing the U.S.-Mexico border. This law is currently on hold as it faces scrutiny over its constitutionality, particularly concerning the authority it grants to local judges to order migrants back to Mexico regardless of nationality. Filipina nurse Camila Cumilang lives in the border town of Brownsville, Texas. She says she has strong opinions about immigration that she keeps to herself. Her focus is her job.
My duty is to provide quality health care regardless of your race, your gender, your age, your religion. So I find fulfillment in my role as a healthcare provider.
Cumilang says she sees firsthand what people in her town need. So she does what she can to help out, like providing free medical care at a local shelter. And finally, in entertainment news, with over 3,500 performances, the musical Aladdin recently celebrated its 10th year since it opened on Broadway in 2014. Filipino Don Daryl Rivera plays the role of Iago, Jafar's famous sidekick. Performing 8 times a week has become a way of life for the Seattle, Washington native.
It feels really incredible. I mean, to see a show like that thrive on Broadway is really spectacular.
Rivera talks about the most challenging aspect of being an actor.
The occasional reminder that we're all different and not necessarily in a good way. I occasionally forget. I'm like, oh yeah, I am Filipino, right? Because everyone has been so welcoming, but every so often there's a couple moments here and there where I have to overcome that and represent stronger and be prouder about it.
Broadway's Aladdin is performed daily in New York's New Amsterdam Theater.
And those are the news-making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
Israel withdraws more ground troops from Gaza, leaving just one brigade in the Strip 6 months after the start of its offensive. The move comes as Egypt prepares to host a new round of talks aimed at reaching a ceasefire and hostage release deal. Israel's defense minister says the troop pullout is to prepare for future operations, including the enclave's southern city of Rafah.
The forces are exiting and preparing for their next missions. We saw examples of such missions in the Shifa operation, and also of their coming mission in the Rafah area.
The Israeli military has been reducing numbers since the start of the year to relieve reservists. Israel is also under growing pressure from Washington to improve the humanitarian situation in Gaza. Thousands gather in Jerusalem to demand the release of hostages still held in Gaza after 6 months of Israel's war against Hamas. But while talks continue to secure another ceasefire, some hostage families are wary, with the previous rounds of negotiations having gone nowhere and some of the hostages dying in captivity. Speakers largely kept messages apolitical, focusing more on their pain and the urgent need to bring their loved ones home.
Today, because we want everybody to be aware that this is still happening, and we're still hoping that its solution will be like any minute. We don't have time. Nama has no time.
Right now, it's 184 days in captivity. It can be. The world shouldn't condemn it. The world should stand and to be with Israel against Hamas and to do anything that they can do to help us. And for our government, we demand them to do things as soon as possible and not to waste time.
Their families and everybody here is had enough, and people need to understand that, and the world needs to stand up and get them back. Whoever is responsible, we're all responsible, and these are our people, and we can't stand another day without them coming home. And it's above politics, it's above religion, it's a humanitarian issue, and that's what we're here to shout today.
Over the past few weeks, protests against Netanyahu's government have intensified, with some critics saying the veteran leader has been dragging his feet in securing a deal. The United Kingdom warning it could stop selling arms if it receives legal advice that Israel was in breach of international law through its actions in Gaza. British Deputy Prime Minister Oliver Dowden says they are holding Israel to high standards and have raised concerns about different areas of Israel's conduct.
We hold the countries to whom we export arms to a high standard, and I think that's what you'd expect. And it contrasts so strongly our adherence to very high values with the appalling atrocities that are being committed by terrorist organisations against Israel. Now, Israel isn't perfect, long way from it, but this is a difficult conflict, and we're holding Israel to high standards.
There has been growing pressure on the British government to suspend the sale of arms to Israel following the deadly attack on a convoy of aid workers in Gaza. Three former Supreme Court justices have joined more than 600 members of the British legal profession in warning that arms sales could make Britain complicit to the genocide in Gaza. Russian regions in the Ural Mountains hit some of its worst floods in decades. The Ural River swelled several meters in just hours due to meltwater bursting through a dam embankment in the city of Orsk. More than 4,000 have been evacuated. Authorities have also ordered residents in a riverside neighborhood in Kurgan to evacuate, saying the flood waters would soon reach the city. The floods have also affected Siberia as well as parts of neighboring Kazakhstan. A show of force from the Philippines, the U.S., Australia, and Japan. The four countries conducted their first multilateral maritime cooperative activity in the West Philippine Sea Sunday. Their naval and air forces held communication exercises and division tactics within the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. The armed forces of the Philippines said the activities were meant to enhance the capabilities of the defense forces to work together in effectively managing maritime scenarios. In a statement, the four countries said they stand with all nations in safeguarding international order based on the rule of law. They also reaffirmed their position that the 2016 arbitral victory of Manila against Beijing is final and legally binding. Top defense officials from Japan, the Philippines, and the U.S. lauded the recently concluded Quad drills aimed at maintaining regional peace. Japan's defense minister says the South China Sea issue is directly related to peace and stability. He adds Japan opposes any unilateral changes to the status quo and any actions that increase maritime tensions. Manila's defense chief Gilberto Teodoro, meanwhile, called the exercises a step in building the capacity of the Philippines to defend itself. For U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin, Washington's activities with its allies underscore their shared commitment to ensure all countries are free to fly, sail, and operate whenever international law allows. The maritime exercises set the stage for the highly anticipated trilateral summit between the U.S., the Philippines, and Japan this April 11. China's behavior at sea is expected to dominate talks on defense and security. China also flexing its military might. Beijing conducted its own combat patrols on the same day of the joint drills between the Philippines and its allies. Further details were not announced, but China's People's Liberation Army said it held joint naval and air patrols in the South China Sea, adding all military activities that mess up the situation in the area are under control. Beijing claims nearly the entire South China Sea, despite competing claims from other countries, including the Philippines. Philippine authorities appealing to fugitive televangelist Apollo Quiboloy to surrender and face charges. The Philippine National Police says they are already coordinating with various law enforcement agencies to monitor Quiboloy's whereabouts. The PNP also assures the pastor of his safety, adding his sexual and child abuse charges are all bailable.
We believe na nandito po siya sa Pilipinas or nasa Davao region pa po siya. Meron na pong directive, hindi lang sa Pero 11.
Yes.
Including other units, kagaya ng nabanggit niyo po, like sa HPG, sila po maglilid ng convoy ng transportation hanggang Davao International Airport. And then from Manila naman po, Manila International Airport hanggang sa Senate po.
Quiboloy on Saturday denied he is hiding. He insisted he only wants to protect himself against extradition. The pastor also issued conditions before he surrenders to authorities. He said he will face any courts as long as the president and the secretary of justice will make a written guarantee the U.S. will not meddle in his case. Quiboloy has been on the FBI's most wanted list for a series of cases, including sex trafficking and bulk cash smuggling.
Kasi ang gusto po nila ay rendition, yung extraordinary rendition, at mayroon pa po akong patong na 2 milyong dolyares sa ulo ko. Ibig sabihin, 110 milyon pesos si Marcos mismo at ang FBI at CIA. Nagkasundo na po na ako'y ibigay sa kanilang kamay. Ibigay ni Marcos ako sa kamay ng mga puti. Hindi ako magpapahuli ng buhay. Barilin na lang ninyo ako.
A government task force warns the whole country will feel the effects of the El Nino phenomenon by the end of this month. Nearly 20 local government units have declared a state of calamity due to the weather phenomenon, with the agricultural damage climbing to at least 2.63 billion pesos. The task force expects more provinces to be affected by El Nino. It urges the public to conserve and reduce their water consumption.
The end of April, 80 out of the 82 provinces, more or less, meron ng epekto yung El Nino sa kanya. Pero hindi ibig sabihin nun na lahat ng sakahan mapipinsala, lahat ng water reservoir o yung sources of water ay matutuyo. Pero dahil nga sa init na nararanasan natin, kahit pa paano masasabi nating apektado na yung buong bansa. O ipagpaliban po muna yung maintenance at saka yung paglilinis po ng swimming pools hanggat maaari. Again, pakiusap po ito, hindi po ito pagbabawal. Pero po kasi talaga kapag maglinis tayo kahit ng isang swimming pool, napakalaking konsumo po nun sa tubig.